Welcome to another segment of Market Overdrive. It is Wednesday, and although it's really ugly outside, it's a beautiful day in the real estate market. All of us are closing deals, and that's a great thing for America. Can we go there? How are you, Nick?
Wet. Wet.
Okay,
it's wet
on.
Everywhere. I drove here in an hour
care.
And a half of traffic.
I told you this is not a
wet,
time for you
wet,
to come in
wet.
And therapy. Like, this is not about, like, what's your day like today?
I'm wet
like,
everywhere.
How are you today?
I'm taking the day off today.
Okay, because you're wet and
this
you're
is
taking
the only
the day
thing
off.
I'm doing today. This is the only work I'm doing today, so.
You call this work, Nick?
This is, well.
This is how you earn your money.
Well, sometimes I'd like to call it work, but, you know, as I sit across from you, I remind myself that it's torture at times. But hey, we're here. We're doing
it. Good morning. Morena. Can somebody say hi to me?
Hi. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Okay, so this is epic, right? Because this is the first time ever that Market Overdrive is going to host a roundtable discussion about real estate. You know why I did this?
No.
Because we have someone here that has a fan club, and we're hoping that all you ladies and gentlemen call in because Graco Funes is in the house. Don't be jealous.
Hey. I don't know why I'd be jealous of Graco Funes.
Don't be jealous because he's got a fan club.
I'm just listening
don't.
To the conversation, the words that are coming out of your mouth.
I have sunshine because Graco's here,
cool.
Not you.
That's cool.
But
I'm wet.
More importantly, can we please?
Go ahead.
Why?
You criticize every time I introduce a guest, so
well,
let's see how
on.
You do it today.
Graco Funes, would you please do us the honor of
Come
introducing
on.
Our
you
featured
know, you know,
guest?
You know I do a terrible job introducing our guests. So.
Okay, would somebody do their job?
You, I mean, hello. Go ahead.
Why? I'm just going to say the beautiful.
She forgot her name already.
No, I didn't.
She's like,
beautiful
girl. Like, she's like, nobody wants to introduce me. Why is this?
Right. Why is that? I'll be like, Jesus Christo.
See, what it is this is your second time on the show.
What had happened is.
And what had happened,
happened
is.
Was.
And whenever it's someone's second time on the show, we're like, okay, you've been here before.
You're
we,
part
can,
of
we can
yeah,
treat
you
like we can treat you like one of us now. So
I'm
welcome
cool.
back.
I'm cool with that.
Welcome
Thank
back,
you
Sylvia
very
Reyes.
Much. Thank
and
you.
I just don't want to mistake the company, but it's Coa Banker, correct?
No!
Oh, my God.
Wow. He is so wrong.
Wah, wah, wah.
You haven't been briefed. No,
Ooh.
It is not.
Briefing time with the portfolio.
Bro.
Yes, Berkshire Hathaway.
Welcome and congratulations on your move. We will
Thank
miss you because obviously the Coa Banker is a family. Our family will miss you. We
Thank
hope that you come back
much.
One day. I'm just kidding. Keep it together,
it was,
Carla.
It was great. I had both. Places were great. This was just it made more sense for me.
Love it. And that's why today we are talking about real estate questions and answers that you may have as a home buyer or a seller. So please make sure that you are checking in your Facebook because we are Facebook Live every Wednesday at 10 a.m. despite traffic and weather conditions that affect my co-host from arriving on time. Nick, do I still have you?
It's okay, bro.
Yeah, I'm just looking at some of the stuff coming in on social media. That's all.
Oh, look
I'm
at
here.
That. He's multitasking.
I'm working, girl.
I love it. You're working.
You
working
do
it.
You. Let me do me.
I do me all the time. So, go on. Nick, do you have any questions for us?
No, not right now. I'm in the middle of running through some other questions. So go ahead. Just move on.
Love it. Okay, let me go through some of the questions that we've had.
Why don't we have Sylvia give a little intro?
Yes, Sylvia, go ahead and do that.
An intro.
So tell us about your lavish career. I know it's you're early into your career right now, but tell us
yeah,
a little
I'm
bit about where you're
early.
At right now.
You know, I'm just under 3 years into being a real estate broker. But I feel like I hit the ground running. I have a lot of great contacts. I work with a fantastic team, Akko Straub, the group. And, you know, we help each other. This is a constant learning business. In every transaction, you learn something new. And sometimes it's really, really lessons to be learned, you know? And that's why I think today's topic is great. We're going to get a lot of questions, go over questions and answer them for these buyers and sellers. Common, very common questions. However, it's great to touch on them because some people don't, no, they think it's a dumb question, you know? You know, what should I do to sell my house?
How do I start? Where do I get
yeah,
information?
Exactly.
Yes.
So this is the place to go. If you listen in today, you can get the ins and outs of your transaction.
Love it. I think it's imperative, especially in this market, because it's different. It's a different marketplace altogether. I mean, just this week alone, I had an incident where I had a property on the market and we were listed and, you know, we were able to negotiate an escalation clause. So a lot of agents are not familiar with an escalation clause. And that's like the key item or negotiating strategy.
Yes.
An escalation clause is when you submit an offer and there's a bidding war. And so you submit an offer saying, I will give you X amount higher than highest, you know, written offer. And so of course you're going to request that you see the highest written offer, but that's a great way to negotiate a property knowing that your buyer is willing and able and they really want that property and there's no games being played. I mean, we had seriously like 10 offers on these properties, and sometimes that's able to trump everybody that's looking to buy that specific property. So it's a different marketplace. If you're a seller, it is the best time to sell. I've had properties who are not staying on the market longer than 5 days. In some cases, the first person who comes into that property is coming in with an offer. So it's great time to be a realtor. It's great time to be a seller. For buyers out there, don't despair, but do align yourself with an expert that's going to be able to negotiate on your best interest. What are your thoughts on the not the real estate, but the lending world, Nick?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Gregor, you were saying this morning that you had a situation, one of your appraisals didn't pan out, right?
That's the biggest problem.
To touch on the escalation, that's the issue that we're in right now.
Yes. Yeah.
So my client, unfortunately,
Krako, can you do me a favor instead of whispering into the mic and making love to the mic? Can you please speak up because we can't hear you? No,
I'm
see,
right
our
on
producer
the mic.
Is on.
I'm actually
I did a good job.
Mic.
Good thing.
Can you guys hear me now?
Yes.
So my good. Client right now made an offer $5,000 above the list price, obviously to win and have his offer accepted. The problem that we're having now is that the home is not appraising out for, you know, the offer that was submitted. So we're in a situation now where the seller is not willing to negotiate and he wants the buyer to come in with the difference.
Well, let me ask you a question. Was this an FHA buyer?
No.
So the loan is, the appraisal is not stuck with the property. It's not, what do you call it? Not stuck, but what's the word?
Yeah, there's a case number that attaches to on an FHA loan.
An FHA loan, the case number.
That's not the point. What I think what he's trying to say is that this is happening for me in 22 years. I've only seen a purchase not appraise out maybe twice in 22 years. And in the last 2 years, I've seen it like well over 10, 15 times.
Yeah.
Well, that's a problem
and
we're having
with flips.
It's happening
a lot in today's market because, like you said, you got people putting in escalation clauses or you have people going into a property knowing that it's priced well or maybe it's not priced well.
Well, let's
it's just the only one left in the building and then people are firing away and putting offers because they need to be there. And then we just can't, we have a hard time appraising them sometimes.
Well, here's the deal. That's why you have to, you know, you have to know what you're doing as a listing agent. You, when you're pricing a property, you're going to know that there's a threshold of, you know, you want to appraise it, right? It's going to have to appraise out because unless the person that's buying it is a cash buyer that's not going to require an appraisal, a buyer is always going to need an appraisal and the property is always going to need to appraise out. I want to ask if the real estate agent who was listing the property, did they meet the appraiser there? Did they show comps? Did they show lists of items that were upgraded?
Well, I think it, you know, that's all one part of the conversation. It makes sense, but at some point we're talking about there's files that sometimes hit this complete euphoria of like I need to have this house,
right?
And then I don't care what the listing agent provided, I don't care what anybody provided, mm-hmm. It's way over the appraised value.
I mean, Grox, that's a huge disparity though. I'm talking about like what
I
are
had
you
one, I had one
290
yesterday.
What did you say 289 to 275?
I had one $35,000 off yesterday.
It's like insane.
$35,000 off yesterday.
I 100% guarantee you my property's going to appraise out. I'm sorry.
No. Yeah. Listen to this. So
I mean, it's ridiculous.
We did a rebuttal,
okay.
Right? And we combed through
a
everything.
Counter.
Right? A rebuttal on the properties that have sold within the call.
So you contested the appraisal.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they came back with the same price or value on the home. The reason is because the square footage above grade, so people that are out listening right now, keep in mind, mm-hmm. square footage in the basement doesn't count. Okay, so when you're gutting or rehabbing
nor
a home,
the bedrooms.
The bedrooms
right.
below grade, yes.
Right. Yeah. Everything above grade is what the county counts as square footage on a home. So in this situation, our appraiser said, and this is a beautiful home. It's been rehabbed. It's nicely done, finished, great area. But it's 965 square feet above grade, obviously
wow.
not counting the basement. All the other comparables in the area are 1,100 square feet and above. So there's no way that this home is going to appraise out for that. And
I
the
know
seller,
someone
so,
that's flipping a house with two bedrooms above grade and two below grade. I wonder if that person is listening to
I heard
to
it's
this
under
show.
Contract, though.
Is it really?
Yeah.
That so, flip is under contract?
So.
Oh, my gosh.
This ain't the Carla Mina show. It's the Nicki Medi flip show. Those things don't sit around. It didn't even do 24 hours, so stop.
Oh,
anyways,
my gosh.
It was actually sold before it hit the MLS.
You want to share the story?
No.
No?
Because I want to get into the do's and don'ts and stuff to, you know, most commonly asked questions. So I guess a question that's going to come up for anybody watching or listening is, okay, so if I bought a house, I won the bid, and then it doesn't appraise, should I walk away?
Yeah, that's the dilemma my client is in right now.
That's the negotiations for the realtor to figure out. First of all, if you're the realtor that's guiding this transaction, you're going to want to analyze whether the property is fair market value. No one is in the game to overpay for something. You're not paying a premium for something. When I use escalation clause.
The minute you hear it's not appraising, you know that you're officially overpaying.
Listen to me. Let's go back to the root of the question, right? You said that when we're using an escalation clause, you're basically winning a bidding war, but then you're overpaying. There's no such thing as overpaying for a property, because if it's not going to appraise out, the minute I see that there's like an insane number where it's not going to appraise out, I tell my clients, this is not the property for you, because we're always buying with what in mind? Sellability. When I try to resell this, is it going to sell? And who's going to be my target audience when I sell it? If I buy it and it doesn't appraise out, I'm going to be targeting a cash buyer that's not going to care about appraiser.
But you're not using the term overpaying correctly.
We're not overpaying for
the
something.
The value of something
an
is
an escalation clause
as.
Does not constitute overpaying for something. I just want to make sure that we understand that.
Okay. So what are you going to tell my client
then? When the appraisal comes in short?
Well, in that case, I will look at the buyer's agent and be like, why did you submit an offer for this price? And why didn't you look at those specific comps that you're using to send to the lender now when you wrote this offer?
But it's too late now. My client really wants to home. So
which
what
she
are we
can't have
do?
That, or he or she cannot have this property.
You're mixing this all over the
place.
No,
I'm not.
Yes, you are.
How am I mixing it?
You're saying you would look at the buyer's agent. If you're the selling agent, and you asked $350 for a house, a condo, let's just use an example, and everybody was bidding on it, and you ended up selling it for $400. Let's just make it nice and round numbers. And you had multiple $400,000 offers, but you took the best one, the one with the most down payment or cash or whatever. Let's say it's not cash, but it's multiple. You're telling me as a selling agent, you're like, oh, no, I can't take that offer now because you overbid me?
As a listing agent, these are two things that you have to do. A, you have to meet the appraiser. You have to show the appraiser all the offers that you have received for this property. You have to show the appraiser all the stuff that is currently pending that dictates the market, because we're changing markets. You're looking at 3 months of comps that were...
Car.
You're in denial, dude.
What are you talking about?
You cannot fix that problem when the appraiser says there's not one comp. You need to let it go because you're not an appraiser in that aspect. They will not sign off on it.
But you're not letting me finish, right? I'm saying that as a listing agent...
Show them what you want to show them.
Can I speak? Jesus Christo. As a listing agent, right, Sylvia?
Yes.
Thank you, Sylvia.
Yes.
No. As a listing agent, you're supposed to be, if you're going to do this strategy where you're going to underprice something so you can generate multiple offers and then create a bidding war and then get offers above list price and obviously above fair market value, then you have to create a marketplace for yourself. Mm-hmm. And seriously, there's been situations in 2010, 2011 where agents were creating a marketplace for their properties when nothing was selling. We were creating trends.
Okay, let's go through a scenario here.
So the scenario is you meet the appraiser.
Great.
You show them comps.
Excellent.
You show them a list of all the repairs because this is a flip, correct?
And he even said, thank you for your help, and he walked out the door,
and then
right?
Show them a copy of all the contracts and let them know, have you looked at the comps lately? Do you know what this property is worth?
Okay.
Now, if it doesn't come up to price.
Tell me when you're done.
If it doesn't appraise out.
I'm trying to come in too, but that's okay.
Wait a minute. If it's not an FHA deal, which an FHA deal,
it
obviously the appraisal is stuck to the property. Then if it's not, and if it's a conventional deal, if I was 100% confident, and Graco, you know I'm good with my comps, right?
You're pretty good.
Right. Okay. So if 100% confident with my comps, I will kill the deal and go for the next one that's going to give me a better appraiser, because maybe the appraiser wasn't from the area and they didn't appraise it correctly. As much as we like to think that appraisals are objective, they're very subjective, and you can't deny that.
And as much as you like to think you are an official appraiser, you're still not. So after you did your comps and this and that, so I'm like, tell me when you're done. And you shook his hand and said, thank you for your help, Carly. I really appreciate you helping me.
You're welcome.
Blah, blah, blah. He walks out and he turns around and says, still worth $370. That's it. It's not worth $400. He sticks it to you because his report is the final answer.
Like I said, if that's a conventional buyer and I'm 100% confident I can yield my client higher,
you're
gonna
like $400. You're going to go to another lender with another appraiser, and then you do it again. And what happens when it happens again?
Then at that point,
because you're wrong. It doesn't happen like that.
I'm 100% confident the property's going to appraise out, Nick, I'm going to assure you that I'm going to have reasons why I'm going to stick to it. Listen, the market is fierce. I mean, we listed a property for 4.25, right? Yep. And Grok's like,
I love
did you see
appraisers? The market is fierce. That works every time. All right.
Okay. Whatever.
We didn't even get to the question.
In that situation, right? If you're a sell, if you're a buyer, and your property doesn't appraise out, that means that you can't buy that property. You
so
cannot
you're saying
use
walk
financing.
Away, right?
Can
walk
we
away.
Go?
You have to
so
walk
that,
away.
Are we going back to the answer to the question finally?
Just walk away.
The answer to the question is, if you find out that it's worth less than what you paid for it,
you can't buy it.
The advice is walk away or just eat it. I mean, I bought cars that come on the marketplace that have an MSRP here, but it's the only one available.
Why do we always go with cars with you?
Because it's actually more
in
commonly
real
happening.
Estate.
It more commonly happens in cars than properties. Disagree with that.
In real estate, if
and
the property doesn't
you know
appraise out.
When you're buying a certain car, that they're like, hey, if you want it,
it's
$10,000 over the MSRP. That's just it. So you know going in what you're paying for, and you know that you're paying over the price to get it. You know.
Problem here is that the clients don't have
right
over,
so here's
you know.
The situation
you can't do it, you can't do
they
it.
Have no choice.
Okay so guys let's structure this if you were the buyer and mm-hmm. your property didn't appraise out what would be their options Grokko
well it's like Sylvia just said you either walk away or you pay over asking what Nick says
and you pay over asking and that still doesn't cover your down payment you're going to structure it where at the 375 that appraised out you're going to do the 20% of that 375 and then pay the difference $25,000
yeah, mm-hmm.
so
be short.
You're going to be coming out of pocket
you're
a lot.
Very surprised
an
as
extra
to
$10,000 in this situation.
Happen.
And
yeah.
sometimes
that
and sometimes people
they
will pay that. So don't be
exactly.
confused that, you know, go back to your realtor and say, oh, you put me in this predicament. You didn't get your comps right. I mean, I would question that a little bit. But if you're in a situation where you like this property, I mean, some areas in Chicago are just ridiculously insane. Yeah. Logan Square, seriously, it was crazy. 20 showings in one day, 20 showing requests, right, Lucero? For one property. And I'm just like, I only need that one buyer. So it's a lot of work. Lucero's
yeah.
like,
yeah.
She's,
yeah.
And she's shaking the camera.
She's not even,
good, yes.
she's
yeah.
not even
a
show. She's like, yep, that's what happened. Yep.
That's
right.
a good
we
example,
a,
too, Logan Square.
We do have really a caller.
We got a caller sitting around, so why don't we grab the caller?
I don't know how to grab the caller.
Oh you got to push that button right there on the phone.
Hi, Connie. Connie, how are you?
Hey, Carla. Good. Thank you. By yourself.
That's cool. That's
good. Nice. So we decided to have a conversation about, you know, questions and answers that you'd like to ask our mod squad. What is your question for today, Connie?
Okay. So I guess one of my first questions would be just capital gain taxes when I'm selling your home. So that was a huge factor in deciding if I wanted to go ahead and sell my home. So I don't know if I'm not necessarily very informed as to what's the protocol or what to expect. So if you guys could go ahead and cover that would be great.
So specifically, you're selling a property and you want to know with the proceeds from the sale of that existing property, what are the capital gains with that sale or if you should reinvest or how does it work to reinvest back in the market?
I guess, yeah, both questions are great. That in itself, like what are the closing costs for the seller as well?
Okay, so your marketing fee is completely. So we have three questions here. One is, what are the costs associated with selling a property? You're usually going to incur marketing fees, which is going to be our real estate fees that are going to sell your property, and then obviously closing costs associated. I don't want to throw numbers out there because everything is different depending on the brokerage and depending on the realtor. And then your closing costs obviously are going to cover your attorney, title fees, transfer stamps, and all that good stuff. So those numbers, we can't really throw out a number, can we?
From a seller standpoint?
Yeah, from a seller's point.
Well, I mean, we can give percentages.
Range?
You know, the one thing you know, and it depends on how you want to look at this, if you're a seller, you're always looking at your bottom line. What do you get to take home at the end of the transaction as far as
right.
the net proceeds? So a lot of people look at tax credits as a cost. I mean, the reality is we all have to pay our property taxes. So unfortunately, if you're in Illinois, you're always paying your taxes 1 year in arrears. So for example, if you just received the tax bill in March, it was actually paying the tax bill for 2016, not 17. So a lot of people have a tendency to forget this as a seller, and you're typically giving a 1 year tax credit. So if your taxes are $5,000 a year, you have to give that person buying the property that $5,000 credit. So it's another cost
okay.
that we forget often, quite often. You know, honestly, I've been buying and selling homes for a long time. I sometimes forget about the tax credit when I'm doing my own algorithm in my head, like, oh Jesus, I forgot I have to give taxes back. But this title, I mean, if it's a $300,000-$400,000 home, you can expect to pay about $3,000 in title.
So I would just say, like, marketing fees would be anywhere between 5 to 7%, and then closing costs in the high end, closing costs 3 to 4%.
For
sellers?
No, that's.
That's
you know,
high.
Your commissions for realtors
marketing fee
is about 5% or 6%, whatever that
five
might be.
To six, seven.
Right. If you got a seven percenter out there, we can't quote it. If you have one of those out there, then you should probably call somebody. I can quote it. I'm not a realtor, but I think seven's a little on the higher side. That's my opinion.
Damn. Darn it. Dope.
But you know, if you're gonna get into the other fees, you're gonna probably expect on a $400,000 less title report, probably about $3,500 in title fees as a seller. And then, like I said, you're gonna have to give your tax credits. So, you know, hopefully that gives you an idea of what to expect. Now, she had a question about capital gains.
Yeah. So basically, capital gains you will incur if you don't move those funds into another real estate investment. So you want to make sure that you reinvest that money back into real estate. Otherwise, you are going to be assessed at whatever tax level you are. So if you're at 20%, 30%, that's going to be your taxable income. But if you reinvest it into real estate, which is something that I highly recommend, you're not going to get capital gains. You're not going to be hit with capital gains. But of course, I'm not an accountant, so disclosure. I would say contact Nick
Mametti. And she's not an appraiser either, just so you know.
I have an amazing appraiser. But anyway, thank you so much for your question, Connie, and thank you so much for being part of a Market Overdrive team.
And good luck. Good luck with your sale.
Yes, of course. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
You bet. Talk to you soon. Anyway, let's go on. We had some questions here, but I guess my phone was taken away. All right, Lucero, what were the questions that we had pulled
She's
early?
Officially a part of the show today. Hey,
Lucero. Hi, Lucero.
You know, should we be introducing the other guest here? Lucero?
Wait, why can't I ask our producer, Lucero, questions? Unless, of course, you have a question.
Well, what are some of the bigger ones that come up, Sylvia? What's the one you hear more times than none?
From buyers or sellers? Doesn't matter. From buyers?
I'd say buyers.
They want to know how much either above list price or, and they're such vague questions because all of these questions are very relative to the market that they're looking, the area, you know. So the biggest question is, how much should I offer, you know? And of course, that's my job to do the comps and let them know what a good offer would be. And if they want to do an escalation clause, we have that conversation. And when I do an escalation clause, I want them to know, first of all, like, especially when I know what the, or not, no, because I'm not an appraiser either, disclosure. But if I believe
as realtors, if I want, as realtors, right, we give pricing. So we,
right. So when I believe, like, you know, I don't believe that this will appraise, you know, they're telling me that they want to go, they're willing to go maybe $10,000 above list price. Then I want to ask them that question. Okay, well, if it doesn't appraise, because to be honest, I don't think it will appraise. Are you willing to cover that cost yourself?
Right.
And if they want the house really bad, sometimes, yes, they're willing to take on that cost. Other times they're not. So I'd say, well, then let's put the escalation clause maybe only to a few thousand above.
Right.
You know, something that, but you have to have that conversation.
Yes.
And the same as when you're with the, on the listing side, you have to have that conversation. Hey, if we get an escalation clause coming in, we want to put in that if they have to cover that.
Oh,
that,
for sure.
You know?
Yeah. So, and I've had situations where I have to explain to my clients, this is the strategy that we're applying. However, let me let you know that the market corrects itself, right? We're going to have an appraisal come in. So if it's, I don't care that you get something like $200,000 above list price. If it's not going to appraise out because it's always going to be fair market value, then we're not going to be able to get that buyer. Sometimes buyers come in at a ridiculous price. And if you're selling property right now, keep in mind that this is a strategy that people are applying today, is where they'll give you a ridiculous offer. It's not going to appraise out, A, and B, they're going to come back and do an inspection and then nickel and dime you during the inspection. So now what I've done is I'm asking them to give me sold as is. So basically, whatever price we negotiate today, it is as is. You're going to do an inspection. You're going to find out what's, you know, whatever repairs are needed. Mm-hmm. But we're not going to go back and renegotiate value. So that's one way to cover yourself when you're strategically applying these marketing or negotiating tactics. Because like you said, if you have a savvy realtor like Sylvia that's going to advise you, don't overpay. Unless, of course, you're comfortable with paying a premium for today's market. And unfortunately, this is the kind of market that's going to yield some, or demand premium.
Sure. And then you have those really savvy buyers out there and investors who know or really feel in their gut feeling that the home they are buying, and they'll overpay. They'll cover that cost because they feel that that area is either up and coming, it will give it 5-10 years, and it will surpass what they have paid and what it appraised for at the time.
Right. And you're listening to Market Overdrive. We are here to elevate your real estate IQ. We brought in Sylvia Reyes to walk you through the process of negotiating. And of course, questions and answers with the experts. The marketplace is not what it was last year and let alone 3 months ago, because God knows everybody's just so, I think, scared about the interest rate hikes that they just want to be under contract. They want to lock down that rate. And that's why it's creating such a frenzy. And in some of the neighborhoods that are more coveted, like, you know, the Logan Square neighborhoods, Albany Park, it's crazy. Edgewater, Andersonville. I mean, those are, I'm not like steering anybody, but those are the neighborhoods that are not letting anything sit on the market for less than 5 days per se. So talk to your expert and ask him, what is the average market time for these properties? And if something's staying
good question, yeah,
longer than the average market time, that may be something that you can negotiate and you may be able to get, you know, a good deal. But I don't think this is the right market for a shiny penny. There's like no shiny pennies right now. Terry asks, what other loans are available other than FHA or conventional, if any?
So if you're a veteran, Terry, you qualify for the Veterans Program. Those programs are amazing because they're zero down payment and they don't carry any mortgage insurance. There's other programs that we have, which we call portfolio loans for...
Technically, that's classified as conventional.
Conventional, okay.
Yeah, essentially anything outside of, you know, the
all right,
government stuff is
so
a conventional loan.
Those loans are for challenge credit. So if you have a situation where your credit score is just not where it needs to be, or if you have a situation where for some reason you can't verify your income in the manner which you filed your tax returns, we can do a bank statement program where we take an average of the last 12 months. In some cases, we can do 2-year average of bank deposits and use that as your qualifying income. So it's just a matter of taking a peek at your documentation to see where your loan program lies.
Yeah, I'm wondering, I'm sorry to interject, but I'm wondering if that question may be because sometimes they think that the specific type of loan could be confused with the different products that you have. So
yeah, I think
the
question's
that's
like government loan, FHA being low money down, and then conventional being great credit.
Right.
That's not what conventional necessarily means. Conventional is kind of like everything outside of government loans. And there's even programs now, they're opening them up. There's more and more programs coming out daily, but there's, you could have had a bankruptcy literally 2 days ago mm-hmm. and still qualify to buy a house now. I mean, you're going to need a sizable down payment.
Sure.
You know,
but
there's
I
a lot
think
of stuff
that
there.
That could be, and I don't want to speak for Terry, but just to touch a little bit and elaborate more on that is I think maybe that's just to go into some of the other products if you want to.
Call me, Terry.
773-520-4930. There's some great products that I've just
Terry.
Learned about. Yeah.
One question that's arising in the market specifically now where a lot of landlords who were holding properties as rental because they weren't able to sell before, there wasn't enough equity. Well, they put tenants in place in those properties, but now the market is actually going to yield a higher return. So now they're able to sell and get liquidate that property, you know, condo or townhouse that they couldn't sell at that point. And well, the case is now that tenants are still occupying that property. What are the showing requirements when tenants, you know, are in those properties? How do you show and how do you coordinate those showings, Sylvia?
That's really difficult. I'm dealing with that somewhat right now. I'm looking
and
for...
And how does that make you feel?
Right? I'm so sad. Please. I've been looking for some buildings for a few clients. And so if you're listening out there and you're selling, please give me a call. I need a building. It's very hard to coordinate. But if you can get at least...
So what are the guidelines? What are the landlord rights or tenant rights,
well,
per se?
Well, I believe, you know, 24 hours notice at least, but even the tenant can still refuse, you know? So you want to try to, I've gone in just and knocked on the door and asked myself, but not for the day. You know, for a time in the future, just so we have a personal relationship.
So you're representing the buyer or the
buyer?
Okay,
the buyer.
Ooh.
Yeah. No, I've gotten permission.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I've gotten permission.
Like, oh, you just gave me a heart attack.
No. I would never do that. Just get permission. Can I go in and, you know, try to talk to somebody? And of course, I'm not trying to get in that day.
Right.
Just
great.
Coordinate
good
some
for you.
Day.
She's
in the
aggressive.
Next week or
she wants
so.
To get the deal done.
You know what I do?
For sure.
What do you do, Grox?
What do you do?
Because I have that situation right now with one of my properties.
Uh-huh.
I have a tenant and trying to sell. It is 48 hours just for the courtesy of him, and it's on the listing sheet. So every agent that calls understands that it's going to be 48 hours for the tenant to give us permission.
Look at you go.
And then we do an open house on one particular day on a weekend. So that way we're not too intrusive to the tenant, and then we can have masses of people come on one day to create a frenzy.
Right. So I agree. I think that those are really great strategies. You're kind of quiet today.
That's
it's kind of scary because he's over there like.
I'm just listening. Tips and tricks.
Wow,
I want to learn something.
Anyway,
I want to learn something.
Okay, here's what we recommend. We recommend that you apply the in Chicago, right, because we're a Chicago show. Landlord-tenant ordinance summary dictates that you give your tenants 24 to 48-hour notice, 30 days notice, and 60-day notice of the intent to sell. So you're not going to renew that lease. But if you're going to, the way we structure those showings, like Rocco said, is ask the tenant, you know, what are the dates that work for you? Give me a morning date, and then give me an evening date, and then one day out of the weekend for showings. Obviously, this is an inconvenience to everybody. We understand it. But trust me, buyers are not going to wait for your tenant to make themselves available. They're out there, but they're really hungry, and they're going to be knocking down the doors. I mean, we had a property on the market, and it was sick how many people just wanted to see it. And agents were yelling at me, like, you have the right to show this property. Give them 48-hour notice. And, you know, we're trying to keep two relationships going,
totally,
right? We're trying to maintain our selling relationship as well as our tenants' relationship because they're paying rent for this property.
Yeah, that is
so
their home.
Let's be courteous. So I wouldn't advise you to go knock on doors because that just upsets tenants, especially if they're getting a lot of demand, which they are in this market. But for sure, 24 to 48 hour notice. Now, if they don't agree to those rules, then at that point, then you do go ahead and abide by it and, you know, go and show. Give them 24 to 48 hour notice and you're allowed to go in that property. Just be careful, right? You want to maintain that relationship, because if you don't maintain that relationship, closing can be very difficult. Remember, you're still going to have to host that 1 hour, 2 hour inspection. Mm-hmm. You're still going to have to host that appraisal. So if you don't have a good relationship with your tenant, all those things can go south. And also when you're doing the showings, you know, things can come up like, oh, did you know that the toilet doesn't work? Did you know the sink's broken? So maintain those relationships because it's going to help you in negotiations. Why are you laughing, Nick?
I'm just a happy person. What's another question?
It's not that happy face. It's more of that
common
questions
home buyers and sellers
what
have.
Do you have for lending perspective?
I think the most common one here, I actually did it to... I just recently sold a property, put a house on the market, and I actually caught myself doing this. I think if I catch myself doing this, everybody's got to be doing this. It's like overpricing just to see if it happens. How many sellers, you know, you tell them, you know, I think your house is worth $250. That's a good price to list it at. And you're like, well, why don't we just try $270 and see if some...
That's what Carlos said.
See if some jackass comes by and pays $270.
Krakow, you act know, like my stuff doesn't work.
I literally almost caught myself doing it.
Yeah,
myself, and I know better, but this is a very common seller question. Well, if you think it's worth only $250, Carla or Sylvia, why don't you just list it at $300 and see if somebody comes by and does it? What's it going to hurt?
Overpricing?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Go it's down. A very
well,
common. Very,
it is.
It's probably
it is.
The ultimate common seller's question.
Because, well, do you want to know why?
Yeah.
What
go ahead.
I believe is that they take to heart what a lot of the like Zillow and Trulia. What they
ah,
have
another curse word,
you know. sorry, but they take to heart what it says their home is valued at, and then there's a difference between your assessed value and your market value, and they don't get that either. They think that just because your home is assessed at a certain value, that that's what the home should sell for, but market value is totally different. That is what's going on and what's selling in your area. The assessed value is just what your home.
I don't know if that's a Zillow truly a thing though. That's been going on way before Zillow was ever created.
But
sellers
no, when
have been,
you have
always
all
been
this
like, hey,
data
if you,
at your
if you,
fingertips.
If you throw this fishnet out there, if we catch a heck of a lobster instead of some shrimp, let's grab it.
You mean to tell me you haven't had anybody tell you.
That's been going on for 100 years.
Yes, but now that you have the data right in front of your face, easy, you know, at your fingertips,
mm-hmm.
they, it's all the time. All the time, especially with both buyers and sellers. They'll look at, I'm not going to pay this Zillow, the Zestimate says that I should only be paying $320, but it's listed at $415.
I think
because
that,
they don't take in all of.
I think a lot of the digital info out there is creating a new age of problems.
Totally.
But my point is that this particular comment from a seller has been going on way before the internet existed. It's not like it's new because of Zillow. It's been around forever.
Well, that's
why
just
not,
a personal opinion
think,
that they think their home
if
is.
If you think it's worth $250, why don't we just list it for $300 and see if we catch a fish? This is the attitude
then,
of that
sure.
seller. So
and
why
if
don't
you
do
have
it?
Because if you have a, personally, I don't think I would take that listing. If I have a seller who's very adamant on way overpricing it, why do I want to take that on my record?
Because you look bad taking it on.
I'm not going to take on something that's going to sit.
Yeah, so that's a waste of time.
It's going to give me a bad record. And if somebody looks up my record and they say, what, she had this, why would she price it that way?
Yeah, and it's not even about that. A lot of sellers don't want to leave any money on the table, right? That's a long story. Like, well, I think it's worth this. And if the market's so great, you're telling me it's spring market, rates are going up, and all these buyers want to buy, then I have a property and they're going to give me premium. Well, again, going back to the situation of price value, I can get you $400,000 above list price, but if it's not going to appraise out, we don't have a deal.
Yeah, that too.
And the chances of somebody paying cash for them are what, 15% buyer marketplace that's going to be cash, and then the other is they're going to be coming in with the loan. So it's unrealistic. You know, so let's not even have that conversation.
Bottom line, you go to your client, your seller, with your arsenal of information. Everything on paper.
Right.
So you can show the numbers. You've crunched the numbers. Everything makes sense to you. And try to get them on your side and see it your way.
It's educating them, right?
Totally.
Consulting them on the comps. We don't make the market. We're just interpreting that, not the numbers.
And you have their best interest at heart. They have to understand that.
So the answer to this person with this thought process is
don't waste your time, because even though it's a hot market, you still want to be realistic. If you're going to sell today, you're going to generate. The flip side is when someone says, why are you underpricing, right? And it's like, again, real estate is a what? A commodity. I'm just kidding.
What did she say that one show? It's not an object.
It's not an object. It's a commodity.
What is it then?
It's going to appraise out. It's going to yield multiple offers. You're going to get multiple offers. So it's going to get what it's worth.
It's not an object.
It's not an object. How was that pricing strategy for you with your sold in one day?
That can be a little
sold
tricky.
In negative days, Nick, on your property.
I was just thinking about selling it. Sold. Put it on the market.
I was thinking of putting it on the market and
like,
it sold.
Oh, sold. Forget it. I'm thinking about it.
Hey,
now.
Guys, it's a great time for sellers out there. Please list your properties. We are dying. We're hungry. Like Sylvia said, everybody wants a two flat. Everybody wants a single family. Everybody wants just something, right?
Yeah.
So great time. And for you buyers, don't despair. I mean, just be strategic about what you're doing. And obviously, real estate is an appreciating asset. So over time, but don't overpay for it, because it's going to take you some time to get that return, right? Just be conservative, right? I'm always on the conservative side, but don't get yourself into a situation you're not going to be able to get yourself out later. Because
such a conflicting comment, though. Don't overpay for it. What is it worth?
Yeah.
Overprice. Appraise values.
Oh, God. I think worth the wisdom, my Nick.
You know, it's conflicting. We're over here saying, you know, you're going to have to go above and beyond the listing price because there's a bidding war.
If it's strategic.
It happens.
If it's strategic that way. Because a lot of people price it that way, Nick.
It happens. That's what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
And then the appraiser comes in and says it's not worth that much.
Darn those appraisers.
And then, you know, am I getting ripped off? Am I not? But fundamentally, I learned this about 18, 19 years ago from somebody. It's worth whatever you want to pay for it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Totally.
Yep. Yeah. The difference. Yep.
So, and you're like, am I getting robbed? Am I this? Yeah. Am I that? It's like, no, it's worth whatever. So if you absolutely want to live in this suburb because of the school district and you know that you're paying $10,000 or $15,000 above the asking price, and the appraiser is saying this is above $10,000 or $15,000 above true market value, is it really about the house now or the school system? Is it about the park across the street, or is it about, there's other things that make you want this house.
Exactly.
So now it's worth whatever you want to pay for it.
And in some situations, also, there aren't any comps. Like, I'm doing a deal last night, 10 o'clock at night, we were negotiating this buy. Evergreen Park, there's no comps for a two-flat because everything in that marketplace is single families. So we couldn't find anything in 24 months that had sold in the two-flat category. So what I told my buyer is that the difference is going to be what you're willing to pay for and what the seller is willing to sell it for today. And, you know, it's actually a really, really good deal. Because there weren't any comps. And the other comp, I mean, just to give you the numbers, it was crazy. It was like $129,000 two flat, right? It needs work. But then the most recent sale was for $199,000. So how do you comp that out? And then a foreclosure that sold for $136,000.
Oh,
so a foreclosure, it was like there's such a disparity between numbers. So I was like, let's just give them list price, because at this point, this is a really good deal. And you don't want to start competing with these investors who are going to be making cash offers. And, you know, hopefully today by now we should have good news on it. But you have to be out there. You have to be you have to understand the market, and you just be a little bit aggressive. Any words of wisdom before we part, guys? Any questions or answers or any advice that you want to give our listeners today? Sylvia, you want to start?
Let's see. You know, just especially for first-time home buyers, and maybe some of these questions seemed a little bit, not difficult, but something hard
intrinsic,
to understand.
Like just...
Yeah. And for first-time home buyers, make sure you have a realtor that knows what they're doing, and a way to figure that out is referrals. Ask your neighbor who they used and if they were happy with them.
Good call.
Yeah. And a whole team of people that can answer your questions.
Love it. Great advice. Grox?
Do some homework, right? My clients that we talked about earlier today, I just got a text message that they are going to move forward with this
really?
House regardless.
Wow.
And it's exactly what Nick just said.
Wow.
What are
what
they willing?
What
is it worth
wow.
to you?
Wow.
That's what it is.
And the school district is
I have,
worth.
Good for them.
Yeah. You know, I'm gonna wrap up with a really odd scenario here. I have a buyer buying a nice home in a I don't want to give out details because they might be watching. she's an agent. She's an actual agent herself, the buyer.
Okay.
She's putting the offer down, and it's the one that came $30,000 over price.
Hmm.
Go figure that one out.
So she's going to pay $30,000 out of pocket?
She needs this house.
Yeah. Well, it's, you know,
well,
as realtors, we understand
the market,
though.
We contacted the selling side, and we're working that whole issue mm-hmm. through a little bit, but it's still going to be over appraised value. Yeah. And is she crazy? No. She literally needs this
she
house
well,
for
yeah.
a lot of
yeah.
reasons.
Right.
This is an actual agent
she'll make
that's
it up
paying
at her
over
next sale.
The value. And she knew going in, this might be tough, but I really want this house. I'm like, okay, you're the agent. I don't. What am I going to do? Yell?
Yeah.
At them? I can't say, well, who's
we need
your
to
agent?
Get a, we need to get an appraiser in the studio to kind of yeah. like pick their brains about what's going on in the marketplace. But you've been listening to Market Overdrive. We're here every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. Thank you for sharing our information with your friends and family. Don't forget to go on YouTube and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Also follow us on Instagram and LinkedIn. And, of course, marketoverdrive.com. When are we having that website up and running, Mr. Mamedi?
I think it might be up.
Is it really?
I think it might be up. It's not
spring
today,
market.
It's up.
We can't
I think
even...
it might be tomorrow or next week.
Awesome.
Next week's show. Yeah.
Well, we can't wait for you to check out our new website because a lot of new cool gadgets in place on our website. But for sure, every Wednesday at 10 a.m., Facebook Live at Carla Mina, Market Overdrive. And it's a pleasure hanging out with you every Wednesday. Of course, Sylvia, awesome hanging out with you.
You too. I have had fun just like last time. So
yay.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Grox, your fan club did not respond. I think they were all sleeping.
Yeah. Rainy day.
Rainy day. Nick, not so much you. All right. Can you close this out?
It is closed.
You're still here?
Bye.
Bye-bye. It's over. We'll see you next Wednesday at 10 a.m.
Ciao, guys.
So how do we end this?
You just end it.
Oh, God.
Thank you for watching.
Yes, do that.
Everybody, thank you for watching Market Overdrive today live on Facebook. Our social media following. We appreciate all the fans. Thank you to Sylvia Reyes.
Thank you
for coming on today.
I love how you keep addressing the fans.
You fed this
let them do their thing because they look so cute. Like, look at us.
He actually did something very radio worthy for once.
What was that?
Great.
He spoke.
Right, last time.
He spoke.
It was like crickets coming out of his
right?
Wow, look
right?
at that. Your friend
Sylvia,
loves speaking.
Yeah.
Sylvia. Second time?
Yes.
Hopefully it was as fun as the first time.
It was.
Which one's more memorable? Memorable.
This is a great studio. The other one was really nice too. This is great.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we are happy to have you, and we're happy that you're tuning in every Wednesday at 10 a.m. And of course, follow us on YouTube, LinkedIn, and Instagram. See you again next Wednesday.
Yes.